Well, hey everyone, and welcome back to DCC Online. If this is your first time with us, we are so glad that you've decided to join us today. Also, we would love to be able to connect with you throughout the week. We want you to stay connected with everything that's going on here at Dunnville Christian Church. In order to do that, you can follow me or DCC on all of our social media platforms, including Facebook and Instagram. And if you aren't currently receiving our weekly emails, please make sure that we have your current email address. In order to do that, you can visit our website, dumblechristian.org, and scroll down to the Stay Connected portion of that page. There, you can share all the information that you need with us. And while you're there, if there's anything we can do for you, please let us know. While you may not be here with us during this time, we are still here for you. Now, today, we're concluding our current series called Wisdom. And I am so glad you're watching today to be part of this message, because I believe that this message has the potential to change your life. So let's get started with today's service.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me.
Sing it out, church.
Mind empty praise and treasure that fades and never enough.
So I keep singing.
Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is no satisfied here in your life.
There's nothing, church, just keep singing it out.
Oh, there's nothing the better than you. No, there's nothing that's better than you. Lord, there's nothing is better than you.
Cause I'm not afraid.
Cause I'm not afraid.
My failures and flaws,
my failures and flaws. Lord, you see them all, and you still call me friend.
Amen, church.
He's the God of the mountain. He's the God of the valleys. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me. Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn shame.
that sounds so good this morning, church. Keep singing. There's nothing, nothing,
nothing is better than you.
Excited about concluding our current series, Wisdom, today. The series about how to stop making dumb decisions in life. And this has been an excellent series for all of us. I know for myself, there's a lot of takeaways from this series that I've wanted to go back and even check in on my notes and just remember for life. And just in case this is your first time with us today, or if you hear something today that you would like to go back and revisit, then feel free to go to our DCC app. You can find it in the App Store, Google Play, Amazon, and also our webpage you can find online at dunnvillechristian.org, and check out the previous messages from this series. And while you're there, if you feel like sharing it with a friend, that would be great. Or maybe even listening again to involve yourself in a group discussion, maybe if you have a small group or even just with your family. Well, we would love for you to go and check out those previous messages and even past message series that you can find there on the DCC page. Now, this series has been important for all of us, and the reason it's been important is because there is a truth that we know about every single one of us. We have all made dumb decisions in life. We have all been left with the scars, with the tears, with the exhaustion and the energy that we've expended, the loss of money, the loss of time in life, and everything that comes along with that, and we've been left with those regrets. You know, we've done things in our past that's left us with our head in our hands wondering, why in the world did I do that? And in most cases, we can trace it back to a series of decisions that led us to that conclusion. But we're saying, because we've all made dumb decisions, we don't want to, you know, continue making these dumb decisions, so what can we do about it? And that's where the question, the wisest question ever, has come into play. We've said that in order to stop this, what we need to do is ask this question: what is the wise thing for me to do? In the face of every invitation, opportunity, decision, whatever it may be, every choice that we make, we need to pause and we need to ask this question: what is the wise thing for me to do? And in fact, we've introduced it to you through the lens of three different stages in life to help us gain some clarity on maybe what it is that we should do, right? And so we've asked it this way: considering my past experiences, my present circumstances, and of course, my future hopes and dreams, what is the wise thing for me to do? You know your past, and you know you maybe better than anyone else. You know currently what you're going through and the situations in life, and also your past or your future hopes and dreams, what you hope to accomplish in life. And so in light of these three lenses, we ask, what's the wise thing to do? But over the past few weeks, what we've said is just to ask the question is the start. And I've given you homework to just pretend like you want to be wise, right? And just ask the question, even if you do nothing about it. But then as we progressed into the series, I challenged you to not only ask the question, but to apply the question. Because it's in the application, it's in the doing, not just the knowing, not just asking the question and receiving answers, but in the doing behind those answers that really makes a difference. Now, if you're here this morning and you're a Christian, this is all stuff that you should be doing. This is living our lives for the sake of Christ and for God's purpose and will and His plan. These are the things of asking this wise question. You should be applying it. But if you're here today watching this message and you're not a Christian, let me explain something and just say this to you. Today's message is for you. Today's message is a peek behind the curtain, behind the veil. We want you to know just how much your Heavenly Father loves you and the plan that He has for your life. And so, in order to talk about that today, let me give you a little setup. We are glad you're here watching this today with us. Let me explain a few things to give us a backdrop for today's message. You see, the same for all of us, in every area of life, there are a set of laws and principles that, you know, govern the ways of our life. I mean, just think about it for a minute. There are laws and principles that govern the area of life of medicine, right? Of architecture, of athletics, even in your everyday things such as parenting, your marriage and relationships, your finances, and yes, even your faith. And it's extremely important that we abide by or that we live by these laws and principles. I mean, think about it for a minute. In the field of medicine, with doctors and with surgery, you hope and you live by, or you hope people live by, the laws and the principles that govern our bodies and the way that our bodies work. In terms of architecture, of course, you hope that somebody followed the right plans and understood engineering and design and physics enough that they could construct a building that you would feel safe to enter or maybe even lay your head down at night and sleep, right? In the terms of athletics, athletics have rules and principles, and maybe that's not an area of life that matters most, but it proves the point. You can't play basketball with the rules and principles that govern golf. That would be a bad idea. In your marriage and parenting and relationships, it's the same. There are rules and principles that we must follow, and especially in our faith, that is, you know, the area of life that should govern all other areas of life or be the filter for all other areas. It is extremely important. Now, to explain this, let me say it this way. To make wise decisions in any area of life requires an understanding of, and we have to add this in there, a submission to the laws and principles that govern that area. Meaning this, for wisdom to work, you need both. Now, again, think about a doctor. We want a doctor, when we go see a doctor or we have to have surgery, we want a doctor who has an understanding of the human body and of the tools that they're going to use and then submits themselves and submits their hands, right, to the work and the understanding of the laws and principles of the body. We want an architect who understands engineering, but then also applies that engineering knowledge to do something with it. We want someone who has submitted themselves to those laws and principles. The same thing you would want with your accountant, right? You want somebody who can manage money or manage your finances in your best interest. We want them to leverage that knowledge and those principles and those laws for your good and for my good. And we know that if we leverage them, it will be for good. But if we ignore them, or if anyone ignores the laws and principles that govern life, it can lead to disaster, right? A person could die on the operating table, a building could collapse and hurt people, an accountant could lead someone into financial ruin. And it's the same with every area of life. Now, that's the thing about a principle. You see, I'm not talking about rules, because a rule is something that we establish, that we have established, maybe even in the past. But you can break a rule a lot of times, and there's no real immediate consequence. But if you try to break a principle, the truth is, a principle of life will break you. And that can be dangerous. And so we must allow, and this is a little background to what we're talking about today, we must be people who allow the laws and principles of our lives to influence the decision-making process in our lives. We have to have an understanding of it, and we have to submit to these laws and principles. Such as, I'll give you another example, gravity. Gravity's a great example because this is the reason, gravity, that you don't jump out of, you know, 80-story buildings if you have ever been in one. This means you don't go up to the roof and just jump off because you know that gravity's going to pull you down, right? We live our lives based on our beliefs and our understanding of principles and laws throughout our lives and in every area that provide boundaries, right? Good boundaries. Boundaries to stay within those lanes so that things go well and we experience success. Now, what that means then, right, is that not only do laws and principles influence the decision-making process, but also laws and principles create the context for us for good judgment. You want to know why something is a good judgment call? Because someone has operated within the rules and the principles, or the laws and the principles that govern that area of life. And what is true is that when you and I find someone who understands the laws and principles of life and submits themselves to it, we trust them, right? We trust them. And not only do we trust them, but we actually submit ourselves over to that person who is doing that work. I mean, consider, you trust a doctor to open up your body and to move things around, maybe even take things out and put things back in. And that is such a bizarre idea that we are willing to give someone that much trust. But the reason you do, if you've done your research, is because you see a track record. You see a person who has been successful in that area because they have lived their lives in accordance and within the guidelines, with good judgment, within the guidelines of the rules and principles that govern that area. An architect is no different. That's why you go to bed every night, many of you, and lay your head down on your pillow and sleep soundly, not worried that the house is going to come crashing down due to poor construction. And so, you know, but the question, though, it's bizarre in all of that, why, you know, are we so willing to trust people in that area? And it's because, of course, they have showed us good judgment. It's provided the context for their lives, that they have chosen to apply wisdom and the laws and principles instead of the opposite, which would be to avoid it and experience disaster. And I believe that the same thing is true in our lives in every area. I believe especially in our spiritual lives. In every area, there are laws and principles that govern it. And so that leads me to ask a question, okay? And this is related to every single one of us, just getting a little deeper before we jump into scripture here. But how can we expect others to have an understanding of and a submission to the laws and principles that govern life if we are not willing to understand and submit to them ourselves? Have you ever really thought about it? I mean, we make dumb decisions. We don't want to continue making dumb decisions, and so we have to pause and ask, what is the wise thing for me to do? And if we expect others to do that, then we most certainly should expect it from ourselves. Because we know deep down there is a lot at stake in our marriages. There is a lot at stake in our parenting, right, with our children and with our health and our finances and our careers, and especially in our lives of faith, that filter through which we live out our marriage, that filter through which we are to parent, that we take care of our bodies, that we work as if we're working for the Lord and not just for man. Those areas of life, you know, that are governed by our faith, this is so important. And so to say it this way, as believers, we must be willing to gain an understanding of and a submission to the one who created the laws and principles that govern our lives. You know, in order for us to have the ability to leverage wisdom to its maximum benefit, then we have to address this question. We need to recognize the one who instituted, created, formed, designed those laws and principles that govern our everyday life. The one who is the source of all wisdom. And I think it is for that reason alone that is why Solomon, as we saw a few weeks ago, penned these words. He said in this translation, "Fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom." The fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom. Now, again, we've addressed this before in the series, that wisdom extends beyond just the earth and beyond the now, that wisdom literally is a foundation really for eternal life as well, that if we remove the foundation, and I love that idea, then the house collapses, right, or the building collapses, and the same thing is true for our lives. We cannot remove the fear of the Lord. wisdom requires us to fear the Lord. Now, what does that mean, to fear the Lord? Because perfect love casts out all fear. So we know that God being perfect love for us, that the fear of the Lord actually refers to recognition and reverence that leads to submission. Now, think about this. We first recognize who it is that we are talking about, who it is that we've identified, who is this person, who is this God. And then when we find out who He is, we respond with this reverence that comes from this. And that's what that fear is meaning, that reverence for God. It's an overflow in our lives of the reverence to our Creator, who Scripture says is worthy of all of our honor and glory and praise. He is perfect and holy. There's God and there's everything else that exists. And we are to submit ourselves from that reverence. Then we submit ourselves to Him. And you find this all throughout Scripture. When someone came face to face with an angel of God or even Christ Himself, those people, understanding who He is, understanding God, even Moses, when God would speak to him, they would fall down in reverence, right? And submit themselves to God. And I think that's exactly what Solomon is saying here. We have to recognize and respond with reverence and ultimately our submission to God in order to truly understand wisdom. That is the foundation for our wisdom. And I think you could, you know, summarize it this way. Wisdom begins with a proper understanding of who God is and who we are not. I think that's the first step in identity for everybody, for every reason. That's the first step even for our children in their lives, to understand who their parents are, you know, and they understand that they are our children, that we're going to care for them. And I think this is so important. I think, you know, this is why we're comfortable to submit ourselves to people who have proven their track record of following wisdom and the rules and principles of life. And this is why we're comfortable that when the Holy Spirit moves in our lives and we come to a knowledge of who God is, that we're able to trust Him, that we're able to submit ourselves to Him. You know, He provides, He's the source of every answer we need, of the direction in our lives, of the provision in our lives. He's the source of all things. And that's why Solomon writes this, fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom. And he continues. And he says also that knowledge of the Holy One results in good judgment. And so there's a progression here. When we recognize who God is, and then in reverence we submit to Him, that's the practical side of this, then God begins to reveal Himself more and more, to where we discover more about Him and we gain more understanding of who He is, and that improves, in turn, our ability to choose wisely in our lives. It's so incredible. Or say it this way, the beginning of wisdom is the understanding of and the submission to the One who created everything. In every area of life, there are laws and principles that govern that area, even with our faith and our relationship with God. And we must, to begin this idea of wisdom, understand and submit to the One who has created it all. To the One, understand this, who knows you better than you know you. Think about that for a minute, that no matter what you've ever done in life, everything you've ever said, everything you've ever thought, God knows. He knows you better than you. And still, you find this invitation to come to Him, for Him to provide His wisdom for you. And when we do, there's this cycle that takes place. And it's a cycle that I've mentioned several times before in previous message series. And I think it's something amazing about our lives. But when we choose, and you see it at the top here, to submit ourselves to God, out of that submission, then we come to know Him. As Solomon said, fear of the Lord, you know, the beginning of wisdom, out of reverence we submit, and then understanding of the Holy One. That's life, you know, that's understanding, that's knowledge. And he says, so as we submit to Him, then we come to know Him. And as we come to know Him, then we grow to love Him. And the more that we love Him, the more we see Him working in our lives, the more we grow to trust Him. And as we trust Him, the more then we obey Him, which leads us to submit our lives even more. And that cycle just continues and continues and continues. And when you read Scripture, what you find, and what we believe is true, is that God was motivated by His love for you. Again, regardless of anything you've ever done, and even before you were even born, He loved you. He was for you. And He submitted Himself to you and to the rest of humanity. And you might even think, well, why would God do that, right? Like, why would God care so much about me? And it's because He is love. And why would He give His life for me? And in fact, that's a question that so many of us have. You're not alone in asking that. But just listen for a moment to the words of the Apostle Paul and his explanation of why this took place. He says, when we were utterly helpless, identifying a situation in our lives, when we were helpless, we had no hope whatsoever, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. And Paul is saying the extent of love here is enormous, right? It's so great that God knows you. He knew you and I and all of humanity were without hope. Why? Because of the effects of sin. And sin began, you know, in the beginning with Adam and Eve. We believe that to be true. Jesus taught about Adam and Eve. And so we trust Jesus' words, and we trust that he is who he says he is. And that Paul then, who met Jesus, says here that what his understanding of things are is that God knew that we needed help because we were utterly helpless in our sin. The depravity of man was so deep, and it was a pit that we couldn't get ourselves out of. But just at the right time, in the timing of God, and God only himself knew, he sent Christ to die for us sinners. And so, yeah, we've been identified as a sinner. And God said, yeah, I know that you're a sinner. I know that you've done those things, but I'm still going to submit myself to you. And Christ humbled himself and died on a cross for us. And that's a powerful picture. The picture that we see in this is something called mutual submission. And here what we find in this verse, or what Paul's writing, is the Creator submitting himself to the creation. And in turn, then, the creation given the opportunity to do the same. The Creator loving the creation, and the creation then loving in turn. And this is one of the most powerful relational dynamics that exist. This dynamic should exist in your marriage if you're a follower of Jesus, and it should exist in your parenting with your children, and it should exist in the relationships you have with your friends and co-workers, etc. You should be submitting yourself and putting others first. And rank doesn't matter, birth order doesn't matter, the title doesn't matter, whatever that status may be, it's all irrelevant. And God said, I'll prove it to you. And he did in Jesus at just the right time, again, when we were helpless. I heard this quote one time. I thought it was really neat, and I thought I would share it with you. But God loves you just as you are, and that's true. God loves us all just as we are, even in our broken state and while we were yet sinners, as we'll see in a minute. But God loves us just as we are, and it's and, not but. There's not a contrast. And simultaneously, he loves you way too much to leave you that way, because he knows just the way we are without him is broken and helpless and riddled with sin, okay, and such depravity and such disobedience that we can't even help ourselves, and we don't have our own best interest in mind. And how do we know? Because we've all made dumb decisions, right? We've all made decisions against ourselves. But God said, I love you even in that state, and I love you way too much to leave you that way. That's why I sent my son to die for you. Now, I know for some that seemed difficult to grasp. Perfect love is difficult to grasp, but that's who God is. And Paul even goes on to explain this, some of the contrast here. He says, now, most people would not be willing to die even for an upright person. Like most people, you know, this is why God's so amazing. Most people wouldn't even bother with this, right? We wouldn't, let's admit it. We wouldn't, for most people, we wouldn't die. We won't find this anywhere else, especially in our own lives. Most people wouldn't die or be willing to die for an upright person. Though someone, and he says, but now there might be a small percentage of people who might be willing to die for a person who is especially good. Like this would have to be a super duper special person in their life. There's a possibility. But I think what we're looking at and what God has done, what Paul is saying God has done, that he even looked at us in our awful state with sin and disobedience and said, yeah, you, every single one of you, I'm going to send my son. He's going to die for all of you. You won't find that type of love and that type of grace and mercy and forgiveness anywhere else. Now, Paul continues and says, but God showed his great love. It's his great love for us. And just think about that for a minute. As he's talking to this first century audience, he's still talking about us too. We can read this as it being us. God showed his great love for us, or demonstrated his great love for us, by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And that is a big point. Because of his love, he extends this even in our broken state. while we were still sinners. In fact, we had done nothing good, and even more than that, we weren't even born yet. And God displayed His love, proved His love through Christ. And it's because of His love that He extended that invitation and continues to extend the invitation to the world, even today, to everybody, to you, to me, to everybody, all of our family members, even the ones you don't like, to your greatest enemy, He extends the invitation to them as well, no matter what. For all of us to be able to respond to Him in the same way that He responded to us. Now, let me kind of bring this to an end and make this statement. And this statement is for the end of this entire series, okay? For this entire message and everything we've done, a little summary statement of this. And to say it like this, our willingness to respond to the wisest question ever, what is the wise thing for me to do, really depends upon our willingness to make the wisest decision ever. Now, let me tease this out a little bit. Most of us, okay, and as we look at this, most of us, we see this, that our willingness to make the wise decision really is founded upon, as Solomon is saying, and our willingness to make the wisest decision, which is to, you know, present ourselves to the Lord. And most of us understand this because even without thinking in your daily life, you submit every single day to the laws and the principles of God. Yeah, you do. You leverage the laws and principles of this world and of life all the time for your benefit. Let me give you one example. I used gravity earlier. You probably have taken a plane to go on vacation. You needed that vacation. You wanted that vacation. It was something that you wanted to do. And so you hopped on a plane and you leveraged the laws and the principles of this world to get what you wanted. You leveraged the laws and principles of this world to have surgery, to submit yourself to, you know, having a home built or whatever it may be. You submit yourself to authority, and maybe you didn't know it, but that's also submitting yourself to God because it's His laws and principles that He's established. When you use good judgment and stay within the boundaries of areas of life and decision-making, you are actually submitting yourself to the Lord, whether you know it or not. And so what is that wisest decision ever then? If we're willing to say, okay, we understand a little bit of the wisdom and we want to commit ourselves to it, but it really depends on our willingness to make the wisest decision ever, then what is the wisest decision? And as I said, it's putting ourselves out there, submitting ourselves to the Lord. The wisest decision ever is to fully submit your life to your Heavenly Father. That is the best thing that you could do, the greatest thing that you could ever do. Submit yourself to your Heavenly Father, and what your Heavenly Father says He desires from us is that we would come to know and believe in and trust His Son, Jesus. This is important because we know that if that's the truth, right, then it's the same as we know that if we leverage laws and principles in life, that there are blessings from that. And the same thing is true about the laws and principles of what it means to have a right relationship with our Heavenly Father. To place our trust in Jesus brings with it eternal life, enormous, you know, major blessings in life, of true life. And now, that's the thing. We know and we submit. And in fact, John says that is eternal life, of knowing the Father and His Son and submitting, placing our faith in Christ. And what's amazing about this is so often, we're willing to submit ourselves, right? As we've talked about through this message, we're willing to submit ourselves to the design, but perhaps not to the designer. And that seems so counterintuitive. Or let me ask it this way. If we are willing to understand and submit every day to the laws and principles that govern our lives, why would we resist? Why would anyone resist understanding and submitting to the one who created them? If you look around and understand that laws and principles exist, that they've been determined outside of ourselves and outside of some, you know, notion that, well, they just appeared that way, but they had to have been created, wouldn't you want to know the one who created them? Wouldn't you want to know the one who designed it? So a question, though, for you and for me, for all of us, is have you? Have you submitted yourself to the one who created it all, who designed it all? And if you haven't, listen, I can't think of a better time, a better or greater opportunity or moment than right now to just examine your life for a minute, to think about the fact that you've made decisions in life that were not in your best interest. And if you don't have your best interest in mind, and you've been harmed by others who didn't have your best interest in mind, then who does? And we believe that the rules and principles that exist in life, that govern these areas of life, that create the context for good judgment, all stem from a creator and a designer who had you in mind, who loved you so much that he gave his son for you. And so, as we end this series together, would you take that opportunity today? If you haven't taken that step to place your faith in Christ and begin living your life for Jesus, would you submit to him today to say, look, I submit to his rules and principles every day, right, in every area of life, but you know, I've never thought about maybe submitting my life to the one who created them. Maybe you would do that today. And so I'm going to lead you one more time in asking the question that we've asked throughout this entire series, the wisest question ever, in the context of the three lenses. Considering my past experiences, you know your past. You know what you've been through. You know what's happened in your life. You know your tendencies. You know your strengths. You know your weaknesses. You know your failures. Considering your current situations or circumstances, your present circumstances, you know exactly what's going on in your life today. You know if that marriage is falling apart, if that parenting is tense. You know if your friendships are, you know, are estranged friends or whatever that may be, if there's distance, if there's problems. You know if financially you haven't followed the rules and principles and you're experiencing that pressure. You know in your body, you know, you feel it. You feel the tension. And especially considering your future hopes and dreams, what do you hope to achieve? And is the path you're currently taking going to take you there? Considering all of that, what is the wisest thing for you to do? And in the words of Solomon, he says, the wisest thing for you to do is to fear. To begin that process is to fear, to show reverence to your Heavenly Father, and ultimately to submit to Him. And my prayer for you today, and the prayer of all of us for you today, is that you would know, your Heavenly Father, that you would have an answer today, that you would have hope, that you would begin today and allow your Heavenly Father through Christ and through His Spirit to change your life. One last thing I want to share with you in the words of Solomon. He says this, that he who trusts in his own heart is a fool. If we're going to trust in our own ways, we're just being foolish. But he who walks wisely will be delivered. And my prayer for you personally today is that you would be delivered. That today you would recognize who God is and recognize who you are, a sinner in need of a Savior. And if you're here this morning watching this and you're a Christian, that you would do these things and you would lead others to do these things, that you would take heed to wisdom, and that you would continue that journey in Christ, because we know that leveraging the laws and principles of wisdom brings blessing and brings glory to God and will bring you life. Won't you submit to that today? Now, I want to leave you with some discussion questions, as I have every week, and this week is no different. The discussion questions are here on the screen. They go as follows. First, read Proverbs 9:10 and Romans 5:6-8. After doing so, number one says, talk about a time when you tried to make a wise decision, but things didn't work out. Did you lack understanding of the rules governing that area of life, or were you unwilling to submit to them? Number two, after reading Proverbs 9:10, does the idea of fearing the Lord bother you? Why or why not? Three, what obstacles stand in the way of you saying yes to God in order to understand His wisdom in a particular area of life? How might your life and faith be different if you had submitted to God in that area? And then lastly, in what area of your life do you need to understand and submit to God's wisdom? What is one step you can take this week to do so? Well, once again, thanks for joining us this morning. And let me pray for you before we go. Father, we give you thanks this morning and honor and praise, Lord, that you have loved us so much that you sent your son Jesus to die for us. And today, may we understand that before we can really grasp and apply the principles of life and understanding them, Lord, we need to submit ourselves to you. Before we can ask the wisest question ever, we need to make the wisest decision ever. And for those of us that have, Father, continue to give us your wisdom and give us the strength to live it out each and every day. Help us to see as you see and to do as you say. And for those, Father, that have listened and watched this message today and heard this information and this truth that comes from you, Father, may you impress upon our hearts and on their hearts how important it is that they submit themselves to your son, Jesus, that you want to bring them life. Father, that you love them in spite of anything they could have ever done. They could never do anything more to have you love them more and never do anything less, Father. You love them where they are, but you love them too much to leave them where they are. And for that, Father, we are grateful for your mercy and for your grace. And we pray, Father, maybe even now some of them, that they would take that step in following your Son, Jesus, and submitting their life to him, trusting him with everything in their life to make that wise decision today. God, we love you and we thank you. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. God bless you and have a great and wonderful rest of your week. We'll be right back.